Welcome back. Let's see what's in the kit box today. Already done that one. That one's more complicated than I want to do right now. What do we got here? Sure, let's try that one. That looks like it should be a nice, relaxing kit to build. I wonder what it is. Get some bits out of here. Got a battery holder, that's pretty obvious. Yeah, relatively low part count. That's what I like to see for a day like today. Once I get closer to the end of the month, I'll have more time off work, so I'll be able to do some of those more complicated ones. But right now, I don't really have the bandwidth. So I got two chip sockets, two chips to go with the chip sockets. This one is an HCF4075BE.
The HCF4075 is a triple three-input OR gate. So three input OR gates in one package, just like that. Okay. I don't believe I've played with gates that have more than two inputs. This is kind of neat. Weirdly, I can't find a truth table in this datasheet, but basically an OR gate will set the output high if any of the inputs are high. So if all three inputs are low, then the output's going to be low, but if input one is high, or input two is high, or input three is high, or any of them, then the output will go high.
And this one is a 74LS08N.
Yeah, I thought the 7808 sounded like a standard logic gate. This is a quad two-input AND gate. And the AND gates differ from the OR gates in that both inputs have to be high, so input A and input B have to be high for the output to go high. Otherwise, it'll stay low. And here we have an actual truth table, which is what I was looking for with that other one. So if A and B input are low, the output's low. If A is low, B is high, the output's low. If A is high, B is low, the output is low. But if A is high and B is high, then we have a high output.
So other than those two chips and their two sockets, we have some resistors, which are... well, three of them are the same, two of them are different. I'm hoping there's some silk screen on the board. We have a little buzzer here with its dust cap so that it doesn't get mucked up in commercial soldering, which I'm not doing. We have three pushy buttons, which makes a certain amount of sense, I guess, to go along with that three-input gate. We have an LED, and we have a transistor, which is an S8050. Not familiar with that guy.
Oh, it's just a basic little NPN transistor. Okay, nothing fancy going on there.
And then we have the little circuit board. Not much going on there either. Dual-sided though. The silkscreen doesn't give me values for the components. Doesn't say which one's which, so I guess I'm going to have to rely on the little piece of paper that came with it. I like it when they come with a little bit of paper. I like it even better when they can be self-contained, but whatever. So we have four 1K resistors, a 2K, a 270 ohm, three switches, the battery, one LED. Yeah. Everything else that we expected. Then the schematic. So we have three switches. Each one goes to its own AND gate. The other input of the AND gate is pulled down through a 1K resistor. Sure. Then the output of those three goes to our three-input OR gate, which goes to a resistor and then the LED, and then also a 2K resistor to the base of the transistor, and the transistor drives the buzzer, which has 270 ohms just as a current limit for that. So basically, it buzzes when anybody pushes a button. I guess this is like the game show buzz-in kind of thing. So we'll just get the board set up in the board holder, and we will proceed, I guess, with the resistors. So getting started with the resistors, we have four bundled together there, and we have four 1K resistors in our 1, 2, 3, and 4 positions. So that's easy. I'm just going to chop these resistors off the tape, just so I don't have tape goop left on the ends of the leads to pull through the holes. And I'll just drop these guys in. As is usually the case, unless you have a underlying reason to not do it. It's typically easiest if you put in the lowest profile components first. That's a caveat that you also usually want the components that are least likely to be damaged by ham-fistedness and tomfoolery and, you know, lingering solder and static and all the rest of that crap as you build the rest of the circuit. Now then, last week I completely broke that rule because I started with the surface mount stuff. Well, that's the lowest profile stuff, but a lot of it was silicon. In this case, we're definitely starting with the least likely to be damaged low profile stuff. R5 is the 2K. And those of you who have the luxury of not being colorblind could just read the bands off here. There's the 2K, so that's R5. Unfortunately, especially on these little blue resistors, I think they're blue anyway, they are really, really hard to read the color bands on, even if I could see the colors properly. And this one is the 270 ohm, so that would be R6, which goes up here. Now, if I am lucky, that's the last thing that I will need the meter for tonight. What do you think the odds are that it will actually be that lucky, though? Now, first observation is that board solders very easily. The pads are pre-tinned from the factory, so that's nice. On the downside, like so many modern components, the leads are steel with a coating on them, so they'll stick to your tools if your tools are magnetic. And I know it's maybe not popular, but I really dislike magnetized tools. If I want a magnet, I'll use a magnet. But most of the time, I don't want my tools acting like a magnet randomly. So next, I think I'll solder in the chip sockets. Sockets are, of course, not polarized, but they do have a notch on one end of them, which matches up with a notch on the board just as an indicator so that you can see later on when you put the chip in which direction it actually goes. And it's not critical for that purpose, but it's just an assistance. Of course, if the markings on the board weren't hidden by the socket, then this wouldn't matter, but they are, so it kind of does. Blue tack to hold things in place as I flip the board over, just so that the sockets don't disappear out from under me. But even with that, I'm going to reflow that first join just with my finger pressure on the socket from the backside, just to make sure that the socket is sitting nice and flat to the board. Yes, that was a little bit hot. Now I can get that out of the way because blue tack has this bad habit of melting and getting goopy. I think you can actually see a little bit of it just remnanted there. Fortunately, when it cools off, you can just dab it off like that. Craft supplies coming in handy for soldering. Who would have thought? That went nice and quick, and yeah, there's a little bit of flux on the board. I may clean that up, I may not. It doesn't offend me. Again, this is just for fun, so I don't really care that much. So this buzzer, the tab that was falling off it in the package, is, like I said, supposed to protect it from flux and flux cleaner and stuff, but it also indicates which side the positive is. But it wasn't on. Fortunately, it's marked on there. It isn't always on these things, and there isn't any indicator on the backside, but we lucked out this time and it is marked on the component. And it's marked on the board, so drop him in fairly easily. Now here's a point where I could use the blue tack again, but I'm just going to do it with my finger from the back because it's only two leads. I hope that I don't overheat it and burn my finger. Nope. Nice, quick, painless. Good. Just going to rotate the board around so I can put the switches in without the board holder interfering with it. That's one of the nice things about this board holder. You've got a lot of options when you're putting stuff in. Ooh, they gave me the fancy cookie switches with the red buttons. Not that that matters. Those guys just drop into, they just drop into those holes. And they have sort of pre-bent, pre-splayed legs on them so that they will stay in there. They've got a bit of a friction fit and they will stay in there when you're flipping the board around, which is really, really convenient. Even though there's four contacts on here, only two of them are actually wired up to each switch. They could have wired it to all four pins just for, you know, redundancy and stuff, but I don't think it's that critical a circuit, and they don't expect very high, usage on it. So, whatever, that works. I think I'll just keep it in this orientation for the last two components. We have the LED, which is, of course, a red LED. Yep, it is. And as I mentioned before, the long leg is the positive side of the LED, and the flat side of the case is the negative, so you've got lots of clues. Plus, on the silk screen, they have got the flat on there to indicate the negative side. So there that goes. And while I'm at it, I will plug the transistor into its spot too. Again, trusting the silk screen and hoping that they've done it right. It's nice to be able to spin the board around and get it just into whatever convenient location you need it to be. There, that didn't solder very well. There we go. Well, that was super duper simple. I guess I should put some VCC and ground onto there, shouldn't I? That would be the battery box. Can I hold it with the iron? I'll get some solder in here. I don't have that holding three things in two hands trick down that Big Clive does. I wish I was that dexterous, but yeah, just not everybody can do that. I missed a pin over here. Did I miss anything else? One thing about a small board is that it's fairly easy to inspect, and the camera's lens really helps me. Yeah, pay no attention to the flux. I am not concerned about that, and neither should you be in this case. But the solder looks good, and that's all I really care about. So now, plug the chips in. IC1 is the 7408. The notch up there and that dot on that corner indicates that that is pin 1 over there. Either one alone would indicate it, but the two of them together is just, you know, belt and braces, so that's cool. That should, if the pins aren't too badly bent, drop into that socket. Like that. And then we just repeat with the 4075. You see, this guy only has the notch, it doesn't have the dot. But again, that's enough. Along with the notch on the silkscreen and the notch that I oriented on there. I keep harping about this, but it's a really easy mistake to make, especially when you're multitasking or in a hurry or something like that. But there we go. So let's get some batteries into this thing and see what it does. So button 1 does nothing. Button 2 does nothing. Button 3 does nothing. Push 1 and 2 together, I get a buzz. Push 2 and 3 together, or 1 and 3. Okay. So it's not exactly what I thought it was. This one you need two people to agree or push in or whatever before it will buzz. And I'm not entirely sure what the application for that is. And I'm also not entirely sure what the point of these three gates is other than to buffer this guy. Well, I guess it combines them a little bit because it is, yeah, we need anding, okay. So, I didn't notice that before. So here's what I didn't notice before. These switches go to two different gates. So switch 1 goes to the first gate and the third gate. Switch 2 goes to the second gate and the first gate. Switch 3 goes to the second and third one. And then all of them are pulled up, okay. I was not paying attention when I started off this thing. So once again, in my rush to just get to the fun part, the soldering, I didn't pay too much attention. So what I originally thought was if it was just whichever one of them's pushed, then we just need the OR gate. But now I see why we need the AND gate as well. So you need two buttons pushed. All right. So now, can you guys figure out for me why you would want this? I mean, it's a useful little demonstration of how the gates work, I suppose. But other than that, what does it do? Did you guess that's what it was doing? Three-person voting machine. Okay, so it's giving you some soldering precautions. It's telling you the color code of the LEDs. And it's telling you that the LED lead length indicates the polarity. Wow, that is actually nice. So I could have translated that before I did it, but for me, a lot of the fun is trying to figure it out on my own. The reverse engineering, the just understanding what the components do and how they interact. And yeah, I didn't get it perfect, mostly because I was rushing, but it is pretty straightforward, and a nice relaxing kit build is just what I needed on this cold winter's day. Well, if you've got any questions or comments, throw them down below as usual, and I will talk to you later. And for the people who are wondering what this is, because there always is some, this is Infernal Fusion Machine Black Ale from Dastardly Villain Brewing in Winnipeg. They are steadfast students of stupendous stouts. And yeah, this one is pretty good. Possibly fantastic, definitely really good.